Okay, welcome to Word Without Walls. Welcome to the Tuesday night sunlight service. This is Dwelling Place Part 8. We're going to end the series tonight, and I'm finally going to get to 1 John. But before I do that, I want to read Psalm 90, verse 1, and then I want to read a story in Mark chapter 5, which I really think the story in Mark chapter 5, hopefully it, I really think it kind of sums up what this whole series has been about our dwelling place, about the place where we live, the place where, you know, we kind of make decisions from, our dwelling place, our mind, the thing in between our ears that can so often be such a problem or such a distraction or such an enemy, which is why we looked at tearing down the high place and about, you know, really looking at what we sacrifice, really looking at what we focus on. So first, Psalm 90, verse 1 has been our key verse for this whole series. And it says, "A prayer of Moses, the man of God. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations." So again, you know, the foundation is our dwelling place is God. It is Jesus. It is love. And when we understand that that's our dwelling place, when we understand that that's where we live, that's not something we need to get. That's not somewhere we need to arrive at. That's somewhere we are right now. That's something we have right now. That's something that we are right now. That's who we are. Then we can begin to understand how this quote-unquote Jesus thing, this Christian thing, it's not just a part of our life. It literally is our life. It doesn't just affect every decision we make, but really, it's the source of every decision we make. So let's look at Mark chapter 5, starting with verse 1. And I kind of want to read most of the whole story here. So I'm just going to read it in the King James Bible for time's sake. And in the King James, Mark chapter 5, starting with verse 1, reads like this. "And they came over unto the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit." And he is Jesus we're talking about. And in verse 3, this is important, it says, "He who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains." His dwelling place, or our dwelling place, as it were, before this experience with Jesus, Jesus comes over and has an experience with this man, and it's going to change everything. But before he has this experience with Jesus, his dwelling place is among the tombs. All he has are dead thoughts. All he has are dead works. All he has is a lie to believe in because he's never experienced anything else, because he doesn't know anything else. That's where he's always been. He has an unclean spirit. He's a living soul, and he hasn't been yet filled with the Holy Spirit. So again, this is a picture of mankind before the cross, and then Jesus comes in, and then we're going to see the effect that Jesus has. But I thought it was interesting too, in verse 3 of Mark 5, it says, "No man could bind him, no, not with chains." There's no external force that can make us be who we're supposed to be. The law cannot modify our behavior to the point where we will be able to live up to the law's standard. It's just not possible. It just can't happen. And it's not supposed to. Because even though the law is good and the law is perfect, the law has to be used lawfully. And the point of the law was never to get us to act a certain way. The law was to bring us to the end of ourselves, to bring us to faith, to bring us to Christ. When we finally try so hard and then we figure out that we can't do it, then we can say, okay, I can't do this. I need a Savior. I need Jesus. And then Jesus steps in, and as we're going to see even in this very story, Jesus steps in and all those bonds are loosed and all those chains that religion tries to put on you, that the world tries to put on you, that the lie tries to put on you, he frees you from that. And that's why the Bible says, "Whom the Son sets free is free indeed." And that's why the Bible says, "The truth will not only set you free, but it will make you free." There's a whole transformation when we see that Jesus is the one who tore down the high place, when we see that Jesus is the one who put off the old man or killed the old man or crucified the old man, and when we see that Jesus is the one who not only is our dwelling place, but we are his dwelling place, when we see this total and complete identification with Jesus, then we see how all of this makes sense. Then we see how all of this can be real. Then we see how all of this can manifest. So it goes on in verse 4 and it says, "Because that he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces. Neither could any man tame him. It doesn't matter how hard, even yourself, you can't tame yourself. You can't be anything other than what you are. So then a big part of my ministry, the Lord told me, since we can't be anything other than what we are, he said, son, start telling the people who they are. He said, listen, if you reveal me to my people, then they will see themselves in me, and then they will know who they really are, and then they won't have to try to be anybody else. We can just be who we really are when we know who he really is. So it's not about all these chains on us. It's not about all these rules. It's not about all these hoops to jump through. It's just simply about understanding who we are in Christ, who we are because of who Jesus is. Because again, not only is he our dwelling place, but we are his dwelling place. Not only is he where we live, but we are where he lives. Not only is it in him that we live and move and have our being, but it's in us that he lives and moves and has his being. So again, there's this connection, there's this unity, there's this total and complete lack of separation where Jesus drew us into himself and he planted himself in us. And that's how, when he died, we died. That's how this new creation came forth out of the dead seed, out of the corruptible seed, rather, came forth an incorruptible seed because of the cross, because of the death, and then the resurrection. So this is when everything changed. First of all, it was, you know, we see a rule and we want to break it. That's quote-unquote human nature before the cross. But, you know, I'm convinced that human nature on this side of the cross, it's just love. We have a new nature, and it's a love nature. We have a new DNA, and it's the divine nature of the Almighty. We have a new name, and it's Jesus. It's God with and within us. It's love in a body. It's the Word made flesh. It's him living his life in and through us. And that's what we're going to get to. But in verse 5 it says, "And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones." And again, the stone speaks of the law. So he's like he's living among the tombs. He has all these dead thoughts. He has all these traditions. He has all these things that people have told him. You're supposed to do this. You're supposed to do that. And he's always in the mountains. He's in the tombs. He's trying as hard as he can. He's doing the best that he can with what he has. But all he's doing is he's cutting himself and he's isolating himself and he's banging his head against the wall. And the only thing you can get when you bang your head against the wall is a headache. He's not having any success, which religion does not offer any success. Maybe some limited, you know, it's seeming success at the beginning. But at the bottom line, you know, I heard it once said, you know, a smoker's going to smoke. So, you know, if we want to take that analogy further, a sinner's going to sin. It's not until you're saved by grace and you understand that I'm not a sinner anymore, that I'm a saint, that I'm not a servant anymore, but I'm a son. It's not until that transformation happens. It's not until you understand your dwelling place and understand how to live there and how to live out of there. It's not until that shift happens. It's not until an experience with Jesus that you can stop trying so hard to be somebody else and you can just be who you really are. So then, and this is awesome to me in verse 6, it says, "But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him." He saw something different. He saw a more excellent way. He knew that the things he had been trying to do were unsuccessful. He knew that the things other people were trying to do to him and for him were unsuccessful. He knew he needed a solution, and then he saw Jesus, and he ran and worshipped him. "And cried out with a loud voice and said, What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not." So, you know, on some level, I think he was afraid that he was going to get more of this religion. He was going to get more of this angry God. He was saying, listen, I know that I need you, but I don't want you the way that you've been presented to me. Which is how a lot of people are today, especially people who don't go to church. I mean, I hear all the time that people don't like church, but I don't really hear very often that people don't like Jesus. They just don't seem to understand that there's a difference between the traditions of man and the Word of God. And if we start showing them the Word of God, which is love, and if that word of love begins to be made flesh, just as it was when Jesus walked the earth, when what's in us starts to come out of us, when we remember who He really is, when we remember that He loves us and always has and always will, when we start taking what we have and then sharing it and giving it away and releasing it, then I think people are going to, you know, they're not going to be so anti-church or whatever you want to say. I think they're going to flock to it. I think they're going to run to it if we can present them a solution, if we can show them a more excellent way. And then Jesus, you know, he's not worried about it. He's not worried about what this guy's, you know, afraid of. He says in verse 8, "For He said unto him, Come out of the man, thou unclean spirit." So Jesus is just like, you know what, I'm here. I'm the answer, I'm the solution, whatever you need, you find it in me. You have an unclean spirit, I'm going to cast him out. You're stuck in religion, I'm going to give you rest. Whatever it is that you need, it's found in Jesus. Because He not only provides for us, but He is our provision. He is our bread, He is our water, He is our, you know, wine, He is our lamb. He is everything that we need that will sustain us and allow us and equip and empower us to live this abundant life. Which again is just Him living His life in and through us. So in verse 9 it says, "And He asked him, What is thy name? And he answered, saying, My name is Legion, for we are many. And he besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country. Now there was there nigh unto the mountains a great herd of swine feeding. And all the devils besought him, saying, Send us into the swine, that we may enter into them. And forthwith Jesus gave them leave, and the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine. And the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea. They were about 2,000, and were choked in the sea. And they that fed the swine fled, and told it in the city and in the country. And they went out to see what it was that was done." I'm kind of moving fast through all of that. I don't want to deal with that. I want to get to verse 15, which says, "And they come to Jesus, and see him that was possessed with the devil, and had the legion, sitting and clothed, and in his right mind. And they were afraid." When we started this story, he was living among the tombs, and he was bound up, and they were trying to shackle him, and they were trying to, you know, get him to modify his behavior, and they were trying to make him act a certain way and do a certain thing. He couldn't handle it. He couldn't do it. It didn't make sense. It didn't equate. He has an experience with Jesus. Jesus is the solution. And they come back, and they find him clothed in his right mind. The high place was torn down, and the mercy seat was resurrected. Religion was cast away and grace entered the scene. And again, that's what happens to us on this side of the cross now. We have been given our right mind. We have been given the mind of Christ, the heart of Christ, the Holy Spirit of Christ. We are now clothed. Remember a couple of weeks ago when we looked at the words, you know, when it says put on this, put on that, and what it means is to sink into a garment. He clothed us, and now we're just enjoying the clothes that He's given us. Now we're just wearing it, and again, it's not about following Jesus on this side of the cross as much as it is understanding that He is making His footprints in our feet. It's more about, you know, surrendering to Jesus than it is about following Him. Rather than saying, well, what would Jesus do, and then trying to do that, because that's way too much trying. First you have to try to figure out what Jesus would do, then you have to try to do that thing. Instead of all of that, just let Him do whatever He wants to do in you. That's what it means to be led by the Spirit. Because when the Spirit speaks, it tells you who you are. It tells you that you are God's beloved Son in whom He is well pleased. And then when you understand that, then you understand that you're a son, and then you act out of that spirit of sonship. Then you understand that the Father and the Son are in line. Jesus said, "I and my Father are one." You understand that if God is love, and if Jesus is God in the flesh, that means love in the flesh. That means I don't have to figure out what Jesus would do, because I know what He would do. And what He would do is love. And now what I can do, because He loves me, and because I know that He loves me, and because I believe that He loves me, now what I can do is I can love with that same love. Now I can just receive and release who He is in and through me. And that's what it means to me to be clothed, to be in your right mind. To be sitting with Jesus, to be resting with Daddy, to be enjoying relationship rather than trying to jump through the hoops of religion. So really, I think that story kind of, it encapsulates the cross, it encapsulates this whole message, where only an experience with Jesus will allow you to be who you really are, because He is who we really are. And it's that encounter with Him, that face-to-face encounter, where we see Him clearly, that we see that as He is, so are we in this world. when we look in the mirror with an unveiled face, when we get the law out of the way, when we get the stone out, off of the tomb, then we can come out of death and we can come into life, which is what our dwelling place is, and which is what it says in John chapter 5, verse 24. Jesus says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life." Before the cross, we were all dead in our sins and trespasses. Adam sinned and he ate from the tree of death, and that very day he died. And since a seed can only produce after its own kind, everything that Adam produced was that same dead, corruptible seed, that same rotting flesh, that same perishing flesh. And then Jesus came and he said, "Well, you're not in Adam anymore, you're in me," because of the cross. And he brought us out of death and into life. He translated us out of the power of darkness and into his kingdom. He brought us out of the wilderness and into the promised land. There's so many pictures of this, but it's really the same picture. We have passed from death unto life. And that's, again, that's what the dwelling place is. It's where we live now. And it's not a place of death. It's a place of life. It's a place of light. It's a place of love. It's a place of God's consuming fire. And in the Message Bible, John 5:24 reads like this: "It's urgent that you listen carefully to this. Anyone here who believes what I am saying right now and aligns himself with the Father, who has in fact put me in charge, has at this very moment the real lasting life and is no longer condemned to be an outsider. This person has taken a giant step from the world of the dead to the world of the living." So again, what we're talking about is the practical application, the physical manifestation of living where we are, of taking this giant step out of the land of the dead and into the world of the living. And again, you know, what Jesus did is what Jesus did, and the truth is true whether you believe it or not. But at the same time, if you don't believe it, it's not true for you. So when you believe it, then it begins to manifest, then you begin to experience it, then you begin to enjoy it. And that's what I want us to do. The same thing that Jesus wanted us to do, I want us to enjoy this life that he has given us. I want us to stop struggling so hard to be somebody else and just relax and just really understand that we are who God made us to be when we understand that as he is, so are we in this world. When we understand that he not only gave his life for us, but he gave his life to us, and that he lives his life through us. So stick with that. Remember that phrase, passed from death into life, and turn to 1 John chapter 3. We're going to read a little bit in 1 John chapter 3, and then we're going to read a whole lot in 1 John chapter 4. And then that's how we're going to end this series. So 1 John chapter 3, I want to read verse 14, which connects directly to what I just read in John chapter 5. 1 John 3:14 says, "We know that we have passed from death unto life, because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death." So Jesus said, if you do this, you will pass from, if you believe, you will pass from death into life. And then John says, "We know that we have passed," past tense, the cross happened, this is where we are now, "we have passed from death into life, because we love the brethren." So what is it that we're supposed to believe? To me, it's the ultimate truth of the universe. The Father loveth the Son and has given all things into his hands. What do we believe? What, you know, qualifies us as a Christian, or however you want to say it? Just believing that Daddy loves me. Because when I believe Daddy loves me, then I can love the brethren. And that's the litmus test. That's what John says here. He says, we know this thing is real and practical. We know that we are living in our dwelling place. We know that we have the Spirit. We know that God abides in us and we abide in him because we love each other. And the reason that's so important is without being loved, you can't love. You can't give something you don't have. So until we know and believe the love of Christ, we can't love with the love of Christ. We can love with, you know, the selfish world love of I'll scratch your back if you scratch mine. You know, we can try to follow the golden rule that says do unto others as you would have them do unto you. But that's not perfect agape God love. Perfect agape God love is, I love you because God loves me. And I'm not worried about how you react to it. I'm not worried about what I can get from it because I already have everything I need. I don't need to get anything from it. but you need to get what I have, so I'm going to give it to you. In the same way that I needed it, and Jesus gave it to me. So now scroll down to verses 22 through 24 in 1 John chapter 3, and it says in the King James, "And whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight." And I always like to qualify this whenever you see anything about God's law or God's commandments. God's law is it's not the law of Moses. It's the perfect law of liberty. God's commandments are not the Ten Commandments, not the 613 Jewish laws. God's commandment is, Jesus said, "I have a new commandment I give unto you. Love one another as I have loved you." That's the commandment. That's the law. It's all about love. It's all about being able to love, which again is what the perfect law of liberty is. It's not free to sin, because sin isn't freedom. Sin is bondage. It's free to love and free to live. That's why Jesus came, so that we could have life and have it more abundantly. So again, when it says, whatsoever we ask, we receive of him because we keep his commandments, it's talking about love, okay? It's talking about loving one another, receiving and releasing his love. That's what's pleasing in his sight. What's pleasing in God's sight is not jumping through hoops to try to be more religious. What's not pleasing in God's sight is, you know, self-righteousness that we puff out our chest and say, "Look how good I am." What's pleasing in God's sight is that we know he loves us and we love one another with that same love. And then in the next verse, he even qualifies it himself. In verse 23, he says, "And this is his commandment, that we should believe on the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another as he gave us commandment." So he's saying, just in case you're not sure what commandment of God I'm talking about, this is it. It's the new commandment. It's believing in Jesus, believing that Daddy loves us, and loving one another with that love. That's the commandment Jesus gave. That's the new commandment for a new man in a new covenant. So verse 24 says, "And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him." How do we dwell in him? By loving one another with the love that he loves us with. How do we live in our dwelling place? How do we dwell there? How do we you know, stay there, as it were? How do we know we're there? Because we're loving. Because again, you can't give what you don't have. So if you're loving somebody else, that means that you know and believe that you are loved. Because in the same way that you can't give what you don't have, you can only give what you do have. So if I'm loving you, that means I have love. I am love. So he says, "And he that keepeth his commandments dwelleth in him, and he in him. And hereby we know that he abideth in us by the Spirit which he hath given us." So it all comes back to that spirit of sonship. It all comes back to that relationship aspect. It all comes back to Daddy loves you, now you can love each other. Which again, you know, when we understand that we all collectively are the body of Christ, by loving each other, we're really loving ourselves. You know, Paul talks about nobody hates their own body, but they love and cherish it. And really, you know, there's the bigger aspect is he was talking about Jesus. Because we are Jesus' body. Jesus loves his own body and he cherishes it. But in the same way, when we love each other, we're cherishing our own body because we're all connected. We're all the same singular one body of Christ. It's a many-membered body and it takes all of us and we all have different functions, but we're all one body. So, in the Message Bible, and I like the heading in the Message Bible, it says, "When we practice real love," which again, that's who Jesus is. He's God in the flesh. He's love in a body. He's charity. He's love in action. He's real love being practiced towards one another. 1 John 3:21 through 24 in the Message reads, "And friends, once that's taken care of and we're no longer accusing or condemning ourselves, we're bold and free before God." So again, what we saw in Mark chapter 5, once we have that experience with Jesus, once those bonds are knocked off, once we've moved out of the government of condemnation and into the government of affirmation, once we understand who Jesus is and what he did and what it means for us, then there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ. Then we're not condemning each other or ourselves. Then we're looking through the eyes of grace because that's what we've received. We receive grace, we give grace. We receive forgiveness, we give forgiveness. We receive love, we give love. So that's what makes us bold and free before God. It says, "We're able to stretch our hands out and receive what we asked for because we're doing what he said, doing what pleases him." Again, this is God's command, to believe in his personally named Son, Jesus Christ. He told us to love each other in line with the original command. As we keep his commands, we live deeply and surely in him, and he lives in us. And this is how we experience his deep and abiding presence in us, by the Spirit he gave us. I like what he says here. It says, we live deeply and surely in him. We're not hanging on to the promised land by our fingernails. We're not with Jesus by the skin of our teeth. We are secure in him because he's the rock. He's the foundation. And a house built on the rock will not be shaken. And it doesn't matter what circumstances come because you know who you are and you know whose you are. And look at this. The word, is it here in the next section? Yeah, the word dwelleth here in verse 24 in the King James Bible. It's number 3306 in Strong's Greek Concordance, and it means to stay, abide, continue, dwell, endure, be present, remain, stand, or tarry. So again, this isn't a vacation. Our dwelling place is not a vacation spot. It is our retreat, it is our stronghold, it is our safe place, but it's where we live. We don't go there, we take that with us, because again, it's his Spirit. And again, that's how we know that he abides in us. And that word abideth in that verse, it's the same word. So even as we are staying and abiding and continuing and dwelling and enduring and being present and remaining and standing and tarrying in him, he is staying and abiding and continuing and dwelling and enduring and being present and remaining and standing and tarrying in us. In the Message Bible in Revelation, when it speaks about God dwelling with men, the Message Bible says, look, God has moved into the neighborhood. We are the house that the carpenter Jesus was building for him to live in. It's not about mansions in heaven someday. It's about heaven in your mansion today. That's where we are right now. We're in him because he's in us. We're in the dwelling place because the dwelling place is in us. We have the mind of Christ because the mind of Christ has us. You know, I preached not too long ago a series called Gripped by Grace. And I think that's important that we understand that Noah found grace, but really grace found Noah. Okay? We're always looking for something, but we have everything we need. We just need to see it. And that's what happened to Noah. He found grace in the eyes of the Lord. When he looked God in the face, when he looked at Jesus, when he had that encounter with him, that experience with him, then it stopped being words on a page. Then it stopped being traditions. Then it stopped being religion, and it started being relationship. And that's what this is all about, our relationship with God and our relationship with each other. I've said many times that I believe there's only two important things in this whole universe, and it's God and it's people. And the reason we're here is to love God and to love people, to let God love us so that we can love one another. Because how do we love God? We love people. Jesus said, whatever you do to the least of them, you do unto me. So again, it all comes down to just receiving and releasing. That's how we dwell in our dwelling place. That's how we make this thing real. So continue on to the next chapter, 1 John chapter 4, starting with verse 7. And again, he comes right back to it. John comes right at it and he says, beloved, let us love one another. That's the whole point. And he says, for love is of God. That's how we love one another. How do we fulfill our epic destiny, our eternal purpose in Christ? We let God love us and we love each other with that same love. He says, everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. You can't know God without loving, because that's what it means to know him. To know him is to know that he loves you. And to know that love with the knowledge that passes knowledge, to know the height and the depth and the breadth and the width of God's love, means that you understand that it's too big to be held in. Means that you understand that it's literally bursting at the seams, that it's literally running out of your belly or your heart, like a river of living water. So then it stops being, fake it till you make it love. It stops being, well, yeah, I love him, but not, I'm not going to be nice to him, or, I love him, but I'm not going to like him. Then it becomes so big that you don't have any choice in the matter, because now it's your nature. And how can you go against your nature? That's what we saw, I think it was last week, when we talked about, who knows a man better than himself? Who knows who you really are other than what's on the inside? And what's on the inside is God's heart beating in our chest. What's on the inside is the Holy Spirit whispering in a still small voice, Daddy loves you, Daddy loves you, Daddy loves you. And when you have that much affirmation, there's no room for condemnation. When you have that much light, there's no room for darkness. When you have that much love, there's no room for fear. So again, what's in there is what comes out of there. That's why God gave us the Holy Spirit, His love receptor, to allow us to know what's in there, to allow us to receive it so that we could release it. So John goes on to say, He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. So again, you know, to me, it's just common sense. If you know God, you know how, you know those four-word phrases or whatever? Know God, N-O, God, means know love, N-O, love. But know God, K-N-O-W, means know love, K-N-O-W. If you don't have God, you don't have love. How could you? God is love. And I like it how he says here about you have to know him because, listen, whether you know it or not, you have him. He's everywhere all the time. He's in there. The secret is, again, remember the secret garden? That had everything it needed, but it wasn't until the wind of the Holy Spirit blew through that everything that was in there started to come out. Until you have that experience, until you know Him on a personal level, then you don't know what's in there. You don't know who you are. You don't know what you're capable of. But then once you have that experience, once you know the power of the cross, once you know that you have been saved from your sins and redeemed from your iniquities, once you know that He is not, again, He not only died for you, but He died as you. Now we not only live for Him, we live as Him. When we know the total and complete identification between God and man, then we understand that, of course, without God you can't love, because He is love. So then you understand that, of course, with God, all you can do is love. Because that's how big love is. It's either, really, to me, it's either all or nothing. So he goes on and he says, and I love this verse, and I think I'm going to use this for the next series we get into. 1 John 4, verse 9 says, In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent His only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through Him. The whole point of all of this is to live. Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. The point of this life is not to behave a certain way, it's to live. And guys, to live is to love. To love is to live. So that's why Jesus gave us His Spirit. That's why He gave us what was missing, the knowledge, the revelation, the reception of God's love. Because again, God has always loved you and He always will. But if you don't know that, what good does it do you? So Jesus came to tear the veil. Jesus came to get rid of anything that could separate you from knowing God on a personal basis, knowing God on a relationship level. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. He said, you've had this God and you've had this religion, but all it did was shackle you up. All it did was put you in the tombs. All it did was try to make a dead man dance, as it were. And I'm here to bring you out of death and into life. And the difference between death and life is love. So again, when we understand love, we understand that we are alive to Him. We are dead to sin and we are alive to God. So verse 10 says, Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins. So again, when we talk about love, it's not what we do, it's what He did. It's not what we do, it's who He is. The only reason we can love is because God loves us. Because again, I'll say it again, you can't give what you don't have. If God doesn't love you, how can you love anybody else? If you don't feel loved, you're not going to be able to love. If you feel hurt, you're going to be able to hurt. And, you know, if you feel anger, you're going to give anger. But if you know the love, then you give what you have. So he says, Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. And this sounds like, you know, we could take this to mean he's saying it's a good idea, but I don't think he's saying because God loves us, it's a good idea to love one another. I think he's saying because God loves us, there's nothing else we can do. When we truly begin to understand the love of God, it surpasses everything. Love doesn't just cover a multitude of sins. The Bible says, I think it's in Proverbs, the Bible says love covers all sins. Love is the top, it's the number one, it's God is not just most powerful, He's all powerful. He has all of the power. And God is love, which means love has all of the power. Which means if you want anything to change, if you want anything different, if you want, you know, if you're not happy with how things are, the only thing that will make any difference is love. Because that's where all the power is. And again, that's who we are. Because that's who He is in us. So it says in verse 12, "No man hath seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and His love is perfected in us." So now He's not only saying, in order to live in your dwelling place, you love one another, but now He's saying, when you love one another, His love is perfected in us. Because love is too big to just go, 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 and then stop. God doesn't love me, and then it stops with me. God's love goes from Him to me and then out. It's too big for me to hold in. And when I let it out, it's perfected. When I let it out, you know, again, with no sort of expectation, when I'm loving not to get something, but when I'm loving because I have something, that's perfect love. That's God love. That's God dying for us when we were sinners. That's God drawing us out of death and into life when we didn't have anything to offer Him. When He did it, just simply because He loved us and He wanted us. So it goes on and it says, "Hereby know we that we dwell in Him." How do we know that we dwell in this dwelling, in our dwelling place? How do we know that we dwell in Him? Because He hath given us of His Spirit. Because we have His love receptor. We know that we dwell in Him because we know His love. Because through the Spirit, we understand that the Father loves the Son. We understand that Daddy loves us. We understand that God is love. He doesn't just love. That's not just something He does. That's who He is. So it says in verse 14, "And we have seen and do testify that the Father sent the Son to be the Savior of the world." You can't say that, you can't be a witness unless you witness something. You can't say something that you don't know or believe. I mean, I guess you can. You can repeat something you've heard, but what we're talking about is we're talking about something real, something tangible. We're talking about something that, again, that is world-shaking, that is life-changing. We're talking about the difference between life and death. And it's knowing that God gave His life, that God died for us so we could have His life. So it says, "Whosoever shall confess that Jesus is the Son of God, God dwelleth in him and he in God." And again, you know, people always want to get stuck on this. They always want to say, you know, "Can you confess that Jesus is your Savior?" I had someone on Facebook ask me that one time, and I told them back, I said, "I don't need to be evangelized." And they said, "Well, I have to be really careful who I be friends with." And I said, "Really? Because I just love everybody." And to me, saying that you love everybody is confessing that Jesus is the Son of God. Saying that you love everybody, and again, not just saying it, but doing it, is how you confess His name. Because again, what is His name? The Lord Jesus Christ. What does it mean? Love in a body. Love coming out of a body. God with us and within us and among us and coming out of us. So again, to me, it's not about words you say, but it's about your nature. It's about your spirit. It's about, I mean, and listen, it can be about what you say, but it's about what you do. It's about who you are. And everything flows from that confession of Jesus. Because I didn't write this down, I didn't study this one out, but the word confess, it means agree with. It means say the same thing. So what are we saying? Again, what is the Spirit telling us? The Father loveth the Son and has given all things into His hands. How are we confessing the name of Jesus? Daddy loves me. That's me confessing the name of Jesus. That's saying, as He is, so are we in this world. That's saying, Daddy loves me and I love you with that same love. And that's what it says in verse 16. It says, "And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him." So again, what does that word dwelleth mean? It means to stay, abide, continue, dwell, endure, be present, remain, stand, tarry. Those of us who continue in love, those of us who stay in love, those of us who remain and be present in love, remain and be present in God. We have to knock this wall down that we think God is one thing and love is something else. You know, I kind of debated whether or not to even say this, but But I'm just gonna obey Daddy, and I'm just gonna say it. The other day, I was talking to one of my friends, and we were talking about love, and we were talking about relationships and all these different things. And then when I was done, I couldn't stop smiling because I was like, I just tricked my friend into talking about Jesus without even saying the word Jesus. Because when we talk about love, we're talking about God. When I say I love you, I'm really saying I got you. We don't have to cram religion down people's throats. And in fact, we can't because it won't work. But instead, if we just extend love, people are going to grab it because it's a life rope. It's a life jacket. It's one of those inner tubes that will save you when you're drowning. When Peter walked on the water, what he really walked on was the word when Jesus said, come. He didn't walk on water. He walked on the word of God, which is, you know, again, love. Let there be light. Jesus. So when we have to understand that this whole thing is about love. Our dwelling place, it's about dwelling in love. It's about knowing and believing the love of Christ and receiving it so that we can release it. So it says in verse 17, herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. The same exact way that the Father loves the Son is the way God loves you, because He's the Father and you're the Son. As He is, so are we in this world. We don't have to fear any kind of judgment. And I mean, first of all, we don't have to fear any kind of judgment because Judgment Day was 2,000 years ago on the cross. Jesus, with us in Him, He bore the judgment. He was bruised for our iniquities. He was chastised, and you know, everything was put on Him. He was the scapegoat. He was the sacrificial lamb. So if all our sins are forgiven, if God doesn't even remember them, what are we afraid of judgment for? Judgment, guys, can be in your favor. It can be a good thing. And in this case, it is, because our judgment is life. Our judgment is an eternal life sentence. And there's no room for appeal. He moved into the neighborhood, and He's not moving out. Even as we stand in Him, He stands in us. Even as we abide in Him, He abides in us. And even if we slip, He's not going to slip. He's the rock that is holding us. You know, we always think we're grabbing God's hand, but what we don't seem to realize is He's got a hold of us, and He's not letting us go. So it says in verse 19, we love Him because He first loved us. And that is so key to understand. We don't try to love God, we don't try to love one another. We just simply let Him love us. We get full of that love, and it comes out naturally. Verse 20 says, if a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother, whom he hath seen, how can he love God, whom he hath not seen? So now John's, again, he's trying to make it practical. He's trying to show us that the manifestation of God's love is not from me to some invisible God. It's from me to you. That's how God operates. He operates through His people. He loves me so that I can love you. So again, if I say I love God but I don't love my brother, then really? How does that work? That doesn't make any sense. It's impossible to say you love God without loving your brother, because that's what loving God means. It means loving your brother. It means taking what you have and giving it to those around you. Verse 21, which is where I want to end, it says, and this commandment have we from God, that he who loveth God love his brother also. So again, that is the commandment. That is the new commandment. That's what Jesus said. He said, love one another as I have loved you. In the old covenant, it was love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your mind and all your strength. In the old covenant, it was you better love God or else. You better behave or else. There was always this big stone, really, of the law hanging over our heads, just where if we slipped up, it was going to crush us. But in the new covenant, Jesus is the rock that's holding us up. He's not hanging over our heads waiting to crush us. He's holding us up. He is the one who can keep us from falling. He is the one who sustains us. He is the one who protects us. He is the one who fills us with love so that we can obey this commandment. See, Jesus said it like this. This is kind of the progression that Jesus gave. He gave the new commandment. He said, love one another as I have loved you. He said, if you love me, obey my commandment. And then that's what he said his commandment was. And he said, you know, this is how people will know that you're my disciples, that you love one another. He didn't say, this is how people will know you're my disciples if you jump through these hoops, if you say these certain things. He said, people are going to know your mind if you love one another. Because to the world, that is such a radical idea that you would love with no expectation, that you would love without reservation, that perfect love would cast out all fear, and you wouldn't be afraid to love, you wouldn't be afraid to get hurt, you wouldn't have any fear in the matter at all, because all you're doing is you're receiving from the Father and then just letting it out. Just being filled to the point of overflowing and just enjoying the journey. Just saying, I know Daddy loves me and that's why I love you, and that's enough. That's all I have and that's all I need. I don't need anything from you. And listen, if you want to give me something, I'm not going to refuse it, because again, that's you showing me that you love me, but I'm not in it for that. I'm not loving you so that you'll give me something. I'm loving you because Daddy loves me. And that's what it means to truly live. That's what it means to dwell in our dwelling place. That's what it means to live in the promised land and to enjoy a kingdom economy where we're not just kingdom consumers, but we're kingdom exporters, where we're taking what we have and we're sharing it with a world that desperately needs it, where we understand that the tree of life in New Jerusalem, which was one of our, you know, one of our dwelling places, Golgotha was one. Because Jesus, you know, he fought the battle on the cross in the place of the skull. He gave us our right mind. He clothed us with himself. But in New Jerusalem, when we get to Revelation, we see that there's only one tree in the true paradise of God, the tree of life. And I'm convinced that the fruit of the tree of life is love. And again, it comes in many forms, long-suffering and you know, all those different, what we call the fruits of the Spirit. But it also says that the leaves from the tree of life are for the healing of the nations. It's not just for us to just consume and to just have and to just say, look at me, you know, look how good it is for me. But it's to say, I have something that you need, and just like the Spirit and the Bride, and just to say, come and get it. Just to ring the dinner bell and say, come get some lamb. Come get some bread and some wine. Come get some living water. You're out there and you're dry and you're thirsty and you're hungry. Come and enjoy paradise. Come and see what Daddy has for you at the table that he prepared for you. A 6-course meal of the cross, of being crucified, died, buried, quick and raised and seated. A 6-course meal of total identification with Jesus. Of the stripping away or the crucifixion or the death of the old and of the bringing forth of the new. And this commandment we have from him, that he who loveth God love his brother also. That's what it means to truly be, quote-unquote, a Christian. That's what it means to truly dwell in him, in our dwelling place. That's what it means for him to dwell in us, is that his love in us comes out of us. It's not a commandment that you have to follow or else. It's a commandment that you are now equipped and empowered to follow so that you can enjoy this abundant life that Jesus gave to us when he gave his life for us, gave his life to us, and now lives his life through us. So that's what I have for the Dwelling Place series. And next week we're going to start, I think I'm going to call it Abundant Life. And we're really going to start looking at what it means to truly live, not to have less of a human experience, but to have the fullness of the human experience, which is what Jesus did, which is what Jesus gave us, which is what Jesus wants for us today. So look forward to that next week. Amen.